Hello, everyone. Welcome to CyberScoop TV. Greg Otto, your editor-in-chief here. We're coming to you from the floor of the 2019 RSA Conference, and I'm talking with CTO and founder of BugCrowd, Casey Ellis. Casey, thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
So, there's been a lot of talk recently about BugCrowd and other companies, bug bounty companies, moving into the pen testing space. Talk to me about this strategy of sort of a crowdsourced pen test.
Yeah, it's funny to hear you frame it like that, because BugCrowd isn't... BugCrowd's always been in the pen testing space. Like the initial framing of what we were doing was around basically the use of crowdsourcing, the use of the white hat community to improve things like pen testing through the economics and the resourcing model. So what we did was to use vulnerability disclosure programs and bug bounty programs as a standalone market to grow that piece, but then the learnings from that actually pivot that off into the more consulting model. You know, the announcement that we made over the last 9 months or so around next-gen pen test is really an evolution of that. Previously, running things like private bug bounty programs, for that use, but what we were hearing from the customer is that it needed to require some business usages of testing that go beyond just the ability to be really good at finding bugs. Things like methodology, attestation, things like coverage reporting, things like being able to demonstrate assurance as well as the discovery of bugs as things start to get fixed. So, yeah, I think, from my perspective, it's a logical progression of crowdsourcing or a logical application of crowdsourcing. And for us, really, this has been part of the game plan the whole time. It's like, you get good at understanding what the crowd can do, get very good at connecting them to as much of the security problem space as we're capable of at that point in time, and then just incrementally add to that. And there'll be more of that from us, because that's been part of the strategy the whole time.
So let's talk about that vulnerability disclosure aspect when it comes to the researchers interacting with the companies. We've seen, it's time and time again, we see these stories where researchers, kind of butt heads with the way that they talk to companies or the way that they are releasing bugs. And you're at an interesting standpoint because you're the middleman when it comes to this, when it comes to actual, the crowdsourced bug bounties. What conversations are you having with both the researchers and the companies when it comes to how they're interacting with one another when there is a bug disclosure?
Absolutely. I mean, the golden rule and the thing that we work very actively to help establish, but then also to maintain as a program runs, is you set reasonable expectations, you align those between the two sides, and then you maintain them. Like, you keep the commitments that you've made that you set out when you started as you go through the program, regardless of what pops up along the way, right? And that's not just a vendor thing, it's actually a researcher thing as well. So there's all sorts of different variations of where that can get, wobbly or off track. And we've seen some of those recently. I think the biggest thing is making sure that, really the purpose of disclosure in the researcher community, that's one of the things that I'm seeing as needing to be well understood or better understood right now. There is, the ability to use disclosure of a good bug as something that can promote a pen test company or an organization or even an individual. And I think to the greater degree, that's actually a really good thing. But if that causes a researcher to go ahead and prematurely disclose or to hype out of context an issue that the business decided, no, that's not something that we want to go out and fix just yet, then all of a sudden that's mismatched, it's imbalanced, and, and the problem with it is that the entire relationship becomes adversarial again. Like, we put a lot of work into trying to get everyone on the same page, and hackers and companies historically suck at talking to each other. We've made some progress on that, which is good. So that's really, my goal in this is to make sure that that alignment continues going forward, and that both sides are actually coming to the party. I think for the last 6 years, most of it's been actually getting the companies to come on board and not treat responsible disclosure as a moral loading or some sort of like forcing function they could place on the hacker community, realizing that it's their responsibility as well to treat this information as important and useful, and then to be responsive with that as well. But now it's, as I think the researcher community grows and the velocity of this increases, education on both sides is coming back into the center as important.
So speaking of education, you recently had an announcement with something you're doing around training. Tell us a little bit more about that.
So I think, and this goes back to where we started a little bit around the fact that, like, really what we're about is taking human creativity and applying it to as much of the security problem space as we can, right? What we're known for is, finding really critical issues in production systems at the end of the development cycle. But part of what we've been working on doing and this announcement is a part of, is actually shifting left in that process to help, you know, in development, UAT, but even down to developer education.
Okay.
So we've announced a partnership with Secure Code Warrior, excellent Aussie company, not that I'm biased, but you get that. And the thing that's cool about them is they've made what's fundamentally a really difficult and frankly sometimes boring thing, you know, getting engineers to sit through training and actually understand how to be better at coding securely, really fun. They've approached it with a lot of design thinking, gamification, all of that stuff that we actually do a lot of at BugCrowd as well, to be able to really maximize, you know, the likelihood that an engineer is going to go through this stuff and actually get better and not introducing bugs in the first place. So the way the integration works is the crowd comes in with their perspective, you know, adversarial context and feedback and all of that, to actually steer which parts of that training are most relevant to the organization next, right? Because there's this huge body of things that you can teach an engineering team.
Of course.
Can't eat the whole elephant at once.
Right.
So it makes sense to do the things that are most important first. That's where we're coming together. So I'm pretty excited about that.
Casey, where can people find out more information about it?
Yeah, so bugcrowd.com is the website. There's a ton of stuff on there. There's a partnership page where you can read about the Secure Code Warrior piece. There's more of that coming down the pipeline as well, but obviously this one we're going to be talking about a lot as well. So
great.
Just keeping an eye on us, you'll hear about it.
All right. Always appreciate talking to you, Casey.
Likewise.
Really appreciate your insight.
Thank you very much. Cheers.
For all of our videos, check out our YouTube channel. And for more on RSA and all things cybersecurity, check out cyberscoop.com. I'm Greg Otto. Thanks for watching.